All right. So we've got some slides as well.
Yep, excellent. Awesome.
I'm Ben. This is Antonia.
Hi.
And this is our kids, Theodore and Cedric. We're headed to West Africa with SIM. And we're so thankful for the partnership that we have with you guys in this. And so we wanted to tell you a little bit about our plans and fill you in.
Yeah. So we're going with an organisation called SIM. SIM works in over 70 different countries, particularly targeting least reached people groups, places where it is difficult to get into with the gospel. It's a very multinational team. There's over 4,000 workers from about 80 countries or more. So we're hoping to be part of that team as we work overseas in West Africa.
And so because of live stream and the internet recording things forever, we're not going to be very specific about where in West Africa we're hoping to go.
You can ask us later, but not while we're on screen.
So here's a map that shows West Africa and Australia overlaid if they're at the same latitude. And if you know anything about map projections, you'll understand that sometimes it can be a bit deceiving. So you can see that West Africa is about the size of Australia, and the country we want to go to is probably about the size of New South Wales. But 80% of that country would be the Sahara Desert. So it's a pretty interesting environment to live in. The population of the country we're hoping to go to is about the same as Australia. It's quite a young population. 50% of the population is under 15 years old. And it has one of the highest fertility rates in the world.
I'm well behind with my two kids.
Yeah, so the average is 6.6 births per woman. And that's not necessarily how many children a woman will have, because infant mortality is quite high. But 6.6 is the average number of live births that a woman will have in her lifetime. And they often start... women are often, or girls are often married somewhere between 14 and 16. We met someone when we visited there who was 18 and had just had her second and had no money and no food. It's a pretty tricky situation for people to be in. It's one of the worst situations in the world for education. And it ranks right down the bottom of the UN's education index. Education is something that Antonia is passionate about.
Yep. So we're hoping to work potentially in education. I'm a science teacher and I work in teacher training here in Australia. A lot of teachers and schools, obviously, with such a young population, education is a really big need. But a lot of teachers haven't reached the minimum education requirements or any kind of training requirements. There's a big gender gap between the ability to read and that kind of thing in this country. Only 64% of girls actually end up in schools, and as expected from that, women's literacy is significantly lower than men. It's not helped by the fact that education is in French, which is the official language of the country, but often people don't speak it in their homes, and so there's a bit of a gap there.
One of the other needs is for the gospel. So this map here shows in Africa the different people groups all represented in Africa. This is someone who would a group of people that would say we're distinct to the people over there. We have a different language or culture or whatever it might be, and each of the colours represent a different thing. Green means that there are quite a few Christians, over 2% of the population are Christian. There is a church there. There is active effort into expanding the church and to growing the church in that people group. Orange means that there is some effort, but less than 1% of people are Christians, and there is some effort being made to encourage and grow the church. And red Orange and red means that there is little to no effort, and there is hardly any Christians. And so, as you can see, there's quite a few people groups that have never heard about Jesus and have no idea what the Christian message is. This is, if we go to the next one, the one with the big coloured blobs. There we go. So one thing that's particularly strategic about West Africa is that these people groups kind of represent large areas that don't conform to our Western lines that we drew on the map 100, 200 years ago. And so there are countries where multiple people groups overlap and where the gospel can reach multiple people in one country and then spread out to other countries that we wouldn't be able to go to. And so we're particularly keen to focus on some people that live in these desert tribes, and if we can reach them, then they could go and share the good news of Jesus to their people in places where we wouldn't be able to go, either because of the environment or government restrictions. And so the people that we're hoping to go work with, they're a beautiful people that love their camels, they love their art, their jewellery, their leather work, they love their folk music. On the next one, we've got, and so they've got world famous folk bands. I got to go see one in Newtown a couple of years ago. And so there's this vibrant culture, but it's a culture that once knew about Jesus and has since lost that information and doesn't understand, they don't know anything about Jesus anymore. The team that's in West Africa is hoping to see the church to be made holy and mature and transforming not just their own communities and their own countries, but all of West Africa. And our hope is beyond that West Africa could be a source of missionaries to the entire world. But they're working in lots of different things: disciple making, leadership training, Christian education, agriculture, medical, lots of things to, in a holistic way, trying to improve the lives of people in West Africa, spiritually and physically and economically.
So we went and visited there in 2016-17, and we were able to meet some different people there. We visited a couple of schools. One thing that is a little confusing in this diagram is everyone looks very rugged up. Well, if you look at all the children, they look like it looks like it's minus 15 or something. It's about 21 degrees. So that's just the climate that they're in, that 21 degrees is the temperature you start to put your woolies on. But we were able to work with some different, visit a couple of different schools, visit a couple of different churches, and some people who are working in different ministries over there. And then we had a stowaway on the way back, so we've been delayed for a little while in terms of going. Oops.
So our timeline keeps changing. I'm sure at one point I had 2020 on there. So right now we're looking for supporters and partners, people who can join with us in prayer and in finances. And then we're hoping that we can go to France to do language learning in May next year. We were hoping that the end of the year, this year might be possible. We're not quite ready for that. But if in May next year we can be in France, we'll do a year at least of language learning there, then we'll be all set for West Africa after that.
Mm-hmm. So we're on about 78% of our ongoing support at the moment, and we need to have 100% before we can leave. So we're seeking people to pray and also people to help us support us financially. You will all hopefully have got one of these here. If you have a look inside, there's some a card you can fill in if you'd be interested in either giving a one-off gift or supporting us regularly financially, or alternatively, there is a QR code, which I think the last year has taught everyone to use very effectively, if you wanted to consider supporting us financially. I'm sorry. We need to get out of here.
If you want to be getting our prayer updates, you can do that through the card and you send it off to Sim and then they contact us. If you want to be on the list today, then you can come and talk to me and I'll put you on.
Okay. I think we're going to go to Sunday school now. All right.
Yeah, but I'm going to try and pray for you. Okay. How about that?
That's a good idea.
See you. So can I just encourage you this? As a church, we have decided to support Ben and Antonia. We've been working on this for a while too. When Emily and Alex came to us, when was that? About 2.5 years ago. And so we've been working towards this as well. But as a church, being a supporting church, it's a small amount of money that we give regularly out of our budget, but we also encourage the congregation to support in their prayers and in their financial giving too. And that's what really makes the difference. So I encourage that as well.
We did some calculations that if we had 35 people giving us $50 a month, we'd be good to go, which would be amazing.
So yeah, I'm going to pray for these guys and then we're going to hear our Bible reading and Ben's going to preach for us. So let's just pray. Lord God, we just thank you for the commitment and the faithfulness of Ben and Antonia. And we pray your hand upon not only them, but also Theodore and Cedric too, as they continue to prepare to head off to West Africa. We just pray that you'll continue to not only guide them and inspire them, but also that you will continue to build up the gifts that you have placed within them, the gifts that are particularly suited for this special and important work of not only sharing your gospel, but also helping your people. So we just continue to pray for them. And as a church, also add our own commitment to supporting all those who are in mission. So we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, on a sermon on prayer, let's start with prayer. Lord God, I pray that you would give me the words to speak. You'd give us the ears to hear what you have to say to us tonight, today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you could change one thing about the world, what would it be? Would it be climate change? What about homelessness? World hunger? Slavery? Inequality? If you could only choose one thing, it would be a pretty tricky choice to make. But can you change the world? And we were told all the time that we can change the world. Our little actions can make a big difference. Take your bag to the supermarket, buy ethically sourced clothes, give to charity. Your little things can make a big difference. But often it feels like our little actions are just a small drop in the massive ocean of the problems that the world is facing. I mean, look at Ukraine and Russia. Well, what can we do to change that? And then there's all these other issues. I mean, we can choose we're going to walk to the shops rather than drive. And then we hear about an airline company that offsets their fossil fuels with an accounting trick rather than actually planting trees. And it feels like we haven't even made a dent in the problem. When you think about the immensities of the problems in the world, it's easy to feel powerless. And then we think about the problems in our own lives, the temptations, the struggles, the relationships in turmoil, and we try and nothing seems to change, and we feel powerless. And you think about the vast number of people in the deserts of Africa, where so few know anything about Jesus, and so many have so many needs, and it's easy to feel powerless. And we could say, well, I guess the least I could do is pray. But I want us to see today that prayer is not the least that you can do. In fact, prayer is a powerful partnership with God in mission. Prayer takes us from spectators of mission to partners in God's mission. It takes us from powerless to act in mission and makes us powerful partners of God. And it takes us from proud actors to humble partners. Partners with God, joining him as he works in the world. So first, prayer is partnership in mission. Now, mission speakers often like to explain that there are multiple avenues for people to be involved in mission. And so obviously going overseas, crossing a cultural boundary is really important to mission. It's vital. If no one does it, then there is no mission. But time and time again, people fall into a trap of speaking about these roles in a hierarchy. They might say something like this: God asks you to go, and if you can't go, then give, and if you can't give, then pray. But when we talk this way, we're led into thinking that prayer is the minimum standard, the minimum activity you can do. You know, if you can't do this, then do that. If you can't do that, well, prayer. And leaves us thinking that prayer isn't really that important. But the scriptures don't speak to us like that. In the letters that Paul wrote, he didn't speak about prayer as this nice addition, the bare minimum, like, I guess it's better than nothing. In his letters, he spoke about prayer as if it was people working alongside him as partners. And it's best seen in this passage that was read for us in Philippians chapter 1. And he starts off his whole letter to the Philippians with a prayer of thanks for the Philippian church. And he thanks God for their partnership. In verses 3 to 5 especially, I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your partnership, your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. He doesn't see them as a support, people that enable him to do the work of the gospel. He sees them as partners in the work of the gospel. And at the end of the letter, he thanks them for their financial gifts. And I think, like lots of mission speakers, he finds it a bit awkward and he stumbles a little. He wants to show how grateful he is, but he also wants to show that money isn't his biggest concern. Because for him, giving isn't the most important role that the church of Philippi can play. To Paul, prayer is their biggest role. In Philippians chapter 1, further down in verses 18 and 19, he's just spoken about being in prison and how some people are making life hard for him. But he says then in verse 18, but what does it matter? Just this, that Christ is proclaimed in every way, whether out of false motives or true, and in that I rejoice. And yes, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. Paul wants them to know that his deliverance from his imprisonment will be because of their prayers and the work of the Holy Spirit. He isn't looking for their prayers so that they can feel connected to his situation. He doesn't want them to feel like people in the stands watching a match and cheering him on. He knows that by praying, the Philippian church is making an on-the-field difference to Paul's situation. And he's confident that their prayers will work alongside God and bring him deliverance. There's a well-known missionary who really got this idea, and his name was J.O. Fraser. And he did pioneer work in China at the start of the 20th century with the China Inland Mission. And he was famous for his evangelism, and he put a great deal of credit, however, into his prayer partners back home. And he said to them, I'm not asking you just to give help in prayer as a sort of sideline, but I'm trying to roll the main responsibility of this prayer warfare on you. I want you to take the burden of these people upon your shoulders. I want you to wrestle with God for them. Elsewhere, he said, God's blessing to my ministry can be brought down from heaven by believing prayer, whether offered in China or in England. If this is so, then Christians at home can do just as much for foreign missions as those actually on the field. So we've seen that prayer isn't just about having something to do if you can't be properly involved in mission. Prayer is an integral part of mission. And prayer is powerful. It's because prayer actually works. It does something. As Christians, we can sometimes lose sight of God's power through prayer. And I think we tend to speak of prayer as if it's an internal monologue, a way of reminding ourselves of God's desires, aligning our will with God, and therefore being better at recognizing when God acts. And I think this view of prayer removes its power. It takes its power and makes it this internal reflection that might change our attitudes, but it can't change our circumstances. But the Bible doesn't limit prayer to that. It isn't just a way of being okay with what God is going to do anyway. It's a way of partnering with God and being involved in his powerful work. It's a bit like my relationship with my children. I listen to them, I react to them, I respond to them. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verses 9 to 11, which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask of him? And most mornings, I ask Theo and Cedric, what would you like for breakfast? And sometimes the answer is chocolate. And when they say that, I say no. I'm their father, I care about them, I know what's best for them. They need a proper nutritional breakfast to have the energy to get them through the day, not just the next half an hour. And Jesus isn't saying in this passage, you know, ask whatever you want and God will do whatever you decide. Because nothing can convince me to give my children chocolate for breakfast. But if I ask them what they want for breakfast, they can choose. They can say toast or bread or Weet-Bix, cornflakes. And they influence what happens with their breakfast. I'm still their father. I'm still in absolute control of the menu. But I give my children the opportunity to participate, to partner with me in the food that goes on their plate. In the same way, our Heavenly Father tells us to ask, and he will give us what we ask for. Now, he's obviously not going to give us something that would be detrimental to our spiritual health. He's our loving Father. But if we were to ask for something good, then he wouldn't give us something bad, but he would want to give it to us. I don't always get things right with my kids, with their food. I'm human, but I'm always looking out for their best interests. But if God doesn't have our failings, but is always looking to give us what's best for us, then imagine what he would give us if only we were to ask for it. What does he want to give us then? What's he waiting for us to ask for? Well, he wants us to ask that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He wants us to ask that the gospel would be proclaimed boldly, that the sick would be healed, the demons would be driven out, that God would give wisdom to his people. He wants us to ask for unity of the church, for knowledge of God's will, for resistance to temptation, for strength and endurance. He wants us to ask that the Lord of the harvest would send out workers into the harvest field. And that's what Antonia and I have been praying for years now, praying that God would send out workers and that he would send us out as workers if he would enable it. A friend of ours grew up in West Africa. His parents were workers there, and then he grew up, and then as an adult he went back and served there. But family health needs required him to come back to Australia. But his return to Australia was not the end to his mission work. He gathered people to pray for the desert tribes, and he wrote a book, which you can grab afterwards if you're interested, a prayer guide that allowed people to spend one day a month praying for each tribe in the country that we're hoping to go to. And on just about every page here, it says to pray for God to send out workers to that harvest field. And now Sim Australia is mobilising more people to the desert tribes of West Africa than anywhere else in the world. And it was this prayer guide and his encouragement that led Antonia and I to think about West Africa and the desert tribes. We've been praying for workers to be sent into this harvest field for years, and by God's grace, we hope that we might be the answer to that prayer. And our hope is that some of you would join us in that prayer too, partnering with us and partnering with God's plan to see the desert tribes bow before him in worship. But why does God use prayer to complete his work? Right? If he needs us, does he need us to pray in order to do his work? Isn't God powerful enough to complete his plans without us getting involved? Well, I think the answer is that he wants us involved because he wants us to see how great he is. He wants us to partner with him and to recognise that all success in mission comes from him. Now, in the wet season in the country that we're headed to, the river will often flood. And sometimes that's a good thing, where it floods and provides water for the crops, and other years it's a bad thing and it floods excessively and it destroys people's homes. And a while ago we heard a story of a pastor who had lost his home due to the flooding. And the story was relayed like this. We had some funds we could share with him, and a friend who goes to that pastor's church was happy to deliver the money on the project's behalf, and he shared the following. The day I was asked to take the money to the pastor, my plan was to go find him right after work. Unfortunately, I had to work a little later and decided to go the next day. I arrived, and through the glass door, I saw the pastor and his wife praying and decided to wait in front of the door until they'd finished. A few minutes later, they were done praying, and I knocked in. We discussed about the flooding situation, and they asked me to help them ask around for a house they could move into because all the houses they saw, either the prices were high or the landlord asked for at least 3 months' rent in advance before they could move in. I told them I would ask around. Then I got the money out, I handed it to them, and explained it was help from the missionaries raising funds to help out the pastors that got flooded. He stared at me for a few seconds and said, "We've just finished praying for this." I couldn't hear what they were saying in their prayers when I got there, but he told me they were praying for God's provision so they could pay the 3 months' rent in advance that the landlords were asking for. And I thought, wow, God, you impressed me with how you made this happen. We prayed together and thanked God. And on my way home, I thought, God probably didn't let me go there the first day because I'd probably not find them at home at that time of day, or I would not find them praying at that time of day. I love this story because it shows how important the prayer was. And it might seem like it doesn't matter, right? The money was already decided to go to them before they were praying. Either way, he was going to be blessed by the missionaries, right? But to God, you can see why it really does matter. If the money makes it on the first day, then it's a blessing and it's an answer to prayer. But the missionaries can feel like they're responsible. They did all this great work. But on the second day, rather than it looking like the gift was something that the missionaries achieved together, It's obvious that this was something that God achieved, and the missionaries were partnering with him. God wanted them and their prayers to be answered. And this, I think, is why God chooses to use prayer. And he often waits for us to pray before he chooses to act. If we were to act without prayer, then we'd lose the blessing that comes from knowing that we have joined with God and we are partnering with him in his work. Just think about all the things that God would be delighted to do, but he just wants to bring us along with him on that journey. So prayer isn't just an afterthought, it's a partnership. It's not just a feeling, it's powerful. A powerful partnership with God in his mission for the world. So at this time we might feel powerless, wondering what's going to happen next. But you aren't powerless. You're partners with God, with the God who has the power to accomplish his mission in the world. So please pray with us as we go overseas. Pray for the ministry that's going on cross-culturally right here in Turramurra. And please pray with me right now. God, our Heavenly Father, I pray for the church here in Turramurra. And I pray that their love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so they may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. May they continue to partner with you in your global mission to see every tribe, nation and tongue bow in worship before you. May they be powerful partners in prayer with the workers they support across the world and here at home. May their partnership with you give them insight into your glory and lead them to their greater worship of you. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.